Hey, Golden Gamer, do you know what Gusty tastes like?
What?
Well, I have no idea, actually. I'm gonna probably find out in this next level, which is called What's Gusty Taste Like? It's a quandary that actually I find much more interesting than, any quandaries being examined inside the fanfiction.
Well, anything is more interesting than anything inside this fanfiction.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Alright, so you can start reading in 3, 2, 1, go.
Chapter 5, Fellow Secret, another fucking bilingual chapter. In a graveyard in a
Yippee.
City. Thank fucking God. I can test my vocabulary of Kilgonian. In a graveyard in a city of central Yashin, Fellow is seen alone in front of a certain tombstone. He's holding a bouquet of violets and is wearing formal clothing instead of his usual garb. The name on the tombstone belongs to a female Kilgonian, but before the name can be seen, our sights are paneled onto Fellow's face. Is this like a movie script now? In his mind, he's thinking, hey, it's me again. No one else knew about us. I brought you your favorites. Ever since I left the kingdom to study abroad, I made you the promise to return to you whenever I was finished. Sometimes sacrifices must be made for the advancement of the greater good, but I never thought that would include your life taken away from me. I do not see the good in this yet, but I'm sure somehow I will. It has to happen. Regardless of this, I'm so glad that we met. Rest in peace, my love. A tradition of Kilgonians is when someone is loved, a lot are held in very high regard. One will lean on their beloved one's left shoulder and place their right hand on it. Their left hand will be swiped on the right shoulder and stopped over the end of the shoulder blade. The loved and respected person would then embrace the other. Fellow, because of his height and time constraint, couldn't lean on the grave. He places the flowers in the grave and puts his right hand on it and swiped it with his left. He gives the tombstone one last affectionate look before leaving. Is he in love with the tombstone or the person buried under it? As he leaves, he thinks, one must take these bitter paths alone and bring happiness to everyone they know. Jocelyn always cares that I become a good king. I'll show him that I can. I gotta admit it's difficult. I must hurry. They're waiting for me. In a hotel nearby, inside the cafeteria, we see the four others having breakfast.
All right, hotels.
Yep. You could say it's Hotel Mario. Hey.
Good one.
Not really, but okay. Let's continue. Hey, you guys know where the blue party psycho went? Said Kino. He's messing all the food. Fellow said he was going to an important appointment he had once we reached the village, responded Gramps. He left early this morning, dressed very formally, said Jocelyn, so it must be very important to him. Kino said immediately, he must be going on a date with some unlucky girl. And of course, here we go, another classic, nothing in between the two quotes. You seem to be ignorant of the Kilgonian traditions, said Sheila. While Kino grabbed his heart and said in response to Sheila's comments, that hurts. She continues, even in urban areas, Kilgonians are very homely and quite old-fashioned. Of course, the man openly courts and tries to woo her until he succeeds. Not a single secret about their love was revealed to the world. At that time, Fellow came in and told everyone about his constant sneezing. And wondered if someone was talking about him. Actually, we were just talking about you, said Jocelyn. We were just wondering where you went. It is not like you to be responsible, and to be dressed in some garb like that. Phil immediately gets depressed and embarrassed, thinks to himself, no matter how hard I try, Jocelyn always gets me right here. Why do I enjoy being a party guy so much? Come on, Fellow, cheer up, said Jocelyn. I know it is not like you, but you're making progress. Maybe this time, his kingdom will last an entire day, maybe, said Kino. Kino, making Gramps snicker. That was mean, replied Sheila, making Kino grab his heart even more in a comedic fashion. Fellow sighs and takes a seat at the table. Jocelyn, said Fellow, you always get me where it hurts the most, but that frankness is what makes me respect you. Unlike some idiotic people with an I'm a young PhD attitude. Anyway, I walk in the countryside. I have not been in my kingdom for the 8 years that I studied abroad, plus the 2 that I stayed, waiting for Sheila. And you did nothing else? Asked Kino mischievously. I went to a flower shop to, smell Kilgonian violets. They're on season. But why'd you dress up to go to the flower, just to go to the flower shop? Asked Gramps. Fellow started sweating a bit. I went to an important reunion, and then to, a park and, rested near a certain rock. It was quite soothing, to be honest. Kino jumped out of his seat and told everyone, while bumping his left hip on Jocelyn, "Then let us all go there too. A little more relaxation before continuing our journey is not such a bad idea. Was there a lake close to this rock? A dip in that lake would surely be perfect." "Kino," Fella responded nervously and without delay. "Not everyone can go to that park, and besides, there are many rocks like that one. I wouldn't have want to give away my favorite one to you all." "Well, that settles it," said Jocelyn. "I guess we continue our journey because we need some supplies to be ready for this water-filled place we're going to." "Yes, let's do that," said Fellow. Everyone else nodded their head. On the way to an item shop. Not a specific shop, like a general store or something.
Suddenly we're in a video game universe here.
Yup. They went past a graveyard. Fellow tried to act as calm as possible while she
was... Ghost story.
What?
Get your flashlight out.
Oh, God. Fellow tried to act as calm as possible while she was said, "This is the memorial gravesite of this town. Found 4 years ago?" The graveyard was founded 4 fucking years ago. "Before I left to study abroad, the folks from here tried to hold back a master of flames trying to assassinate my father, the king. Many lost their life. Not their lives. Many lost their life. Their one life. But in vain, unfortunately."
Oh, so they got a game over.
Yeah. "I urged the advisors to erect a memorial, but they decided as a memorial gravesite in the center of the city would be better. They said it would not just honor a particular person or thing. All those innocent lives lost would rest together as equals, but we can't just go inside. We need special permission to go in." Jocelyn turned and noticed that only one grave had a bouquet of violets, and the rest had either an assorted color bouquet or a white one. He thought to himself, "Fellow has been a little fidgety about talking of what he did this morning. Violets, a park, soothing, reunion. Did he lose someone he held dearly or even loved? I don't want him to hurt more, so I'll just stay silent about this." Gramps noticed Jocelyn's meditative facade and asked, "Is something bothering you?" "Gramps, do not worry about it. Thanks for your concern." Jocelyn stops the shop, spots the shop, and exclaims, "Oh, the shop is right over there." "Race you all," said Fellow while taking the lead. "Not fair," yelled Gramps. Fellow did not notice the frost forming at the distance, at a short distance from him. He steps on the ice and flips into the air before landing on his face. "Right behind you," said Kino jokingly as he passed Fellow. A small tornado forms in front of Kino and whirls him inside uncontrollably. "Ha!" yelled Fellow. 2 jets of ocean water blast both into the distance. "Sheila, you better get used to this," said Gramps as he wiped his mouth dry. "We're all friends, but when you combine 2 very similar people, well, you get this." Sheila stood in disbelief as Jocelyn yelled, "You 2 are always like this. What are you guys, 8 years old? When will Gramps and I get some peace and quiet for once? All your fooling around for the past 10 years has always gotten us into trouble." "Okay, Jocelyn," said Sheila. Sheila, with a little concern, Kilgonians of the countryside rather peaceful. Please do not stir them up or they'll start pouncing. A small crowd of serious folks was starting to form, to which Jocelyn responded, "I apologize for my rudeness and my friend's behavior." As soon as the entire crowd dispersed, they were approached by a white Kilgonian man. He had a winged anchor tattooed.
As opposed to white Kilgonian.
No, listen. He had a winged anchor tattooed on his right arm, and his brawny physique just craved a stray look. He wore loose sweatpants and a sleeveless shirt. Just craved of a stray look. A sign that he was a Kilgonian merchant. You must be the 5 youths on your way to Syactus. Please come to my store to stock up on supplies. Rodolfo. Here's the Kilgonian. Rodolfo, eres tú? No sabía que eres de estas partes.
Kino. You know, that sounds like another language, but I can't quite figure out what it is, so.
Yeah,
you know.
It's a little bit. Kino and Gramps were astonished at hearing Fellow speak the Kilgonian language, since they had never heard him speak it before. "Ay, salamencio," he sighs. "Siempre causa un alboroto a donde quiera que va. Espero que sus amigos le estén ayudando a ser un rey de honor y dignidad." What are the fucking odds that they just went to Google Translate and just went English to Spanish?
You fraud!
I swear to fucking God, I bet that's what happened. Fellow dropped his head in shame and amazement. "Embarrassment. Excuse me, sir," said Jocelyn. "Do not worry about that. I am his friend that helps him. It is just that this detail is something we are still working on, but please show us the way. As they made their way over, Kino whispered to Jocelyn, I thought I was the only bilingual guy in the group, though I speak my country's language. Jocelyn responds, Kino, fellow's originally from this kingdom, so no surprise here. I took 4 years of it in high school. Hey, look at that. I'm going to do that too.
I wonder.
So Sheila and Mia...
backstory.
So Sheila and Mia are the only... Sheila and I... But it should be Sheila and I, but... So Sheila and me are the only unilinguals? Asked Gramp. I know a little, responded Sheila. As a matter of fact, my father told me he wanted me to be his ambassador to the Yoshi Kingdom when I came to age. So I decided on learning one language only. As they spoke, they all entered a white building. Jocelyn had not noticed the owner had stopped giving them a small tour... had stopped to give them a small tour of the place and bump into him. This sends shivers up Rodolfo's spine, and quickly turns
unleashing
around,
his inner Heelhauser,
and quickly turns around with an angry gaze and ready to pummel Jocelyn. Sheila quickly steps in front of Jocelyn, astonishing him with her swiftness. Rodolfo stops his fist and says as he lowers his arm, "Disculpame, princesa." Fellow whispered into Jocelyn's ear, "Don't worry, white Kugonian guys are extremely sensitive to other guests touching them. That's why they go over the top somewhat." And just as if nothing had happened, Rodolfo shows them around the store, after insisting to pay for the goods. The party's invited to dinner at Rodolfo's house, only to politely put own the offer. Forgot the D and down. The five then start walking, with Dolphinius as fellow. Who's that? A friend of the family as long as I can remember, replied fellow. He got married a year after I left to study abroad. He retired to inherit his late mother's store. He was a sailor from the 2nd Naval Unit. Oh, so that's what the winged anchor was for? Got it. You know many people, don't you? Said Kino. It's good to know you have reliable contacts over here, said Jocelyn. We better prepare it anyway. We've rested well. Now let's get a head out of this place. To Sea Swamp. Fanfic trivia! Kino's name was influenced by Japan's name for toad, Kinopio. What a big fucking shock. Gillian's name was originally spelt without a U. After researching the name, I found that it was mostly a girl's name, but I liked the name I gave him, so I added a U. Kogonian men who are albino, parentheses, all white, feel more disgusted even by a simple tap by other guys. The exact opposite is true when touched by women. Oh. Author's Corner! Hey everyone, Ed here. I'm really interested in more reviews to write a better tale for your leisure time. Probably the only time I'll do this in story. I know it's annoying. On a better note, thanks to all who have reviewed, and to all those who took the time to read. Fuck you, Ed. Seriously,
well,
fuck Ed. What the fuck?
So we gotta play our game of let's find something good about what we just read.
I just read this whole chapter. I have no idea what the fuck happened.
You know that one sentence of a Spanish... Oh, excuse me. Kyogonian was like probably the best part, which is kind of sad.
Seriously, I just read this. I read all of this. I have no idea what the fuck happened.
Honestly, I kind of feel like I just stared at a blank wall for, however long.
I feel like I just, like, went vacant. Like, nothing was
like,
happening.
Like, I seriously don't even remember, like, anything. Like, I don't even remember...
Swear to God.
I mean, I just played through a couple levels of Yoshi's Island, and I still don't even know what's going on.
Yeah.
Anyways, what's our closing verdict?
I don't
know. 1 out of 6,000?
Negative 50 out of 50?
I give it a big fat goose egg.
I give it
and
a...
And by that, I mean like a literal goose egg, not a Yoshi egg.
I give it a unfavorable review.
Give it a rating of 1 out of 5 and a...
I give it a rating of middle finger, actually. No thumbs up or thumbs
Anyways.
Down. No thumbs up or thumbs down for you. Middle finger.
I give a rating of crash and burn. There we go.
Crash and burn. What do you think about this story, Bean Dude?
Crash, very inspiring.
Crash and burn? I think in crash and burn.
It's inspiring me to crash and burn.
Crash and burn.
the end. That is all there is to it. Good night.